But don't applaud too much, because he's been playing this piece since most of us were born. So he's got a little experience on that. Welcome to First Presbyterian Church this morning. And happy Father's Day. But you know what? At First Presbyterian, we celebrate the Father every day. So every day is special. We're glad that you're here. As you know, this is a little bit different Sunday. A while back, you know, when things were changing in this church, we were done. I remember Pastor getting up here and saying, and then there was one. So the guy said, you know, let's see if we can help out a little bit. So I went to Pastor Kyle and said, what if the guys did a summer service? You know, attendance will be low. And you surprised me there. I thought and she said, that's a great idea. So thank you so much. And as a result of that, Pastor Kyle, we are going to make you an honorary member of First Light. I heard one person already done with this one. I have never seen a cross made out of bacon before. And then, we got our Sunlight Rotunda, and I tried to get this on our bulletin, but it was rejected by staff. And it's a large. And I know that because this is all I had left.
Thank you. confess our sin before God and one another in the prayer of confession. Holy,
Almighty God, we confess that we have not lived for your glory. When enemies attack us, we trust in our own defenses. When deadly storms surround us, we forget that you are with us. Forgive us, God of grace, in our hardship and affliction. Teach us to trust that you alone can deliver us from death to life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Friends, believe the good news of the gospel.
In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Now and ever shall be, world Let us pray.
Oh God, tell us what we need to hear and show us what we ought to do to obey Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, the first lesson this morning comes to us from chapter 15, verses 11 through 24. And you can find this on page 95 in the Old Testament portion. It's New Testament. And the New Testament portion of your pew Bible, also on the screens. Listen for the word of the Lord. Then Jesus said, "There is a man who had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the share of the property that will belong to me.' So he divided the property between them. A few days later, the younger son gathered all he had and traveled to a distant country. And there he squandered his property in desolate living. When he had spent everything, a severe famine took place throughout the country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed the pigs. He would gladly have filled himself with the pods that the pigs were eating, and no one gave him anything. But when it came to himself, he said, 'How many of my father's hired hands have bread enough and to spare? But here I am, dying of hunger. I will get up and go to my father, and I will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me like one of your hired hands.' So he set off and went to his father. But while he was still far off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion. He ran and put his arms around him and kissed him. And the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his slaves, 'Quickly, bring out a robe, the best one, and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. And get the fatted calf and kill it. And let us eat and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead, and he is alive again. He was lost and was found.' And they began to celebrate." This is the word of the Lord.
Please join us as we sing the refrain each time.
Come and follow me.
lamps pray for all but this very.
The second reading is Psalm 103, verses 1 through 5 and 13 through 14, beginning at page 681 in the Old Testament portion of the New Bible. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and do not forget all of his benefits. Who forgives all your iniquity, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with the steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies you with good as long as you live, so that your youth may be like the eagles. As a father who has compassion for his children, so the Lord has compassion for those who fear him, for he knows how we were made. He remembers that we are dust. This is the word of the Lord.
Michael's Father's Day Carol. The players, God and Joshua, also known as Josh. The setting, on Josh's patio, in the evening, just a few days before Father's Day. And Josh is deep in prayer.
Josh,
Tell me about the activities and relationships you share with your children at home and at school, your sons and your daughter.
Lord, my children help me in the yard. They trim the trees, they trim the bushes, they mow the grass, they shovel the snow, and they rake the leaves. They love you so much, and this helps them develop a strong work ethic. In school, Lord, I expect my children to get good grades. However, I also want my children to be athletes. I expect them to participate in the athletic programs offered at school. Basketball, football, soccer, and all the other sports that are applicable. You know, Lord, some of these sports and athletic events take place on Sunday and during Sunday school. But you know, Lord, it's important for my children to participate in sports. It gives them a competitive edge. And Lord, I want to see them play.
Joshua, tell me about your children's church activities and your relationship with them at church.
Lord, my wife expects all of our children to go to church every single Sunday. That is, except when there's a game. I drop the children and my wife off every Sunday that I can.
Drop them off at church?
Yes, Lord. I have to work very, very hard to make money, to pay for this beautiful house, to pay for all the gadgets that we have, the iPads, the iPhones, all those things, two new cars, all the beautiful clothes we wear, all the sporting events and other events we go to, and for my college education for my children. I'm just too busy to go to church, Lord, and I'm too tired. But, Lord, I do my best to go on Christmas and Easter.
Now, Joshua, do you pray with your children?
Yes, Lord. I tell my children to pray to God every chance they get, because praying gives them a connection with God.
Joshua, how do your children feel?
My children, during prayer, hear me say, I love you. I love my wife. And God loves my family, our family. And as we complete our prayer, my children sing a beautiful song. And it goes like this. God's in heaven, and you're here with me. And I want to be like you, Dad. I want to grow up and be just like you. And you know, Lord, if you help me, I can change. I can become the person that you want me to be.
Josh, you are a good father.
Amazing grace. Amen.
Will benefit from two somewhat conflicting psychological principles. First, there's the primacy effect, where people tend to remember the first of any series of events. And then there's the recency effect, where people are apt to remember the last. That means I can say pretty much anything in the next few minutes. And you'll be more likely to remember Mike's provocative parable or Anthony's powerful personal message than whatever I know. With the pressure off, I thought I could stick with the Father's Day theme by looking for a famous father from literature or movies or television who exhibits characteristics of Christian fatherhood that we all might find instructive in that form. My thoughts immediately went to the only TV dad that is regularly seen praying and attending church with his wife and three children. You know who I'm talking about, I'm sure. Yes, Homer Simpson. But when I began looking for relevant parenting quotes from Homer, I found statements such as these. Kids are the best. You can teach them to hate the things you hate. And they practically raise themselves, well, with the internet and all. Or this one, it's the code of the schoolyard, Marge. The rules to teach a boy to be a man. Let's see, don't tap. Always make fun of those different from you. Never say anything unless you're sure everyone feels exactly the same way you do. Or finally, this gem. Kids, you tried your best and you failed miserably. The lesson is, never try. Having struck out there, I decided to go with a story about a father that's found in the Bible. A story with which I know you're quite familiar. It's the story that was read earlier in the service, and is most commonly known as the parable of the prodigal son. A better title might be, however, the parable of the loving father. And it's this loving father that I'll be focusing on. If you read the entire 15th chapter of Luke's gospel, you'll see that the story is the third of three stories where something lost is found. Unlike the first two, where we read about a lost sheep and then a lost coin, here we read about a person who was lost, making it a more accurate description of our own experience of being lost. I want to highlight the beginning and the end of the story, hoping to help all of us to better understand the love that God has shown us. Now, I realize that identifying God as Father is not necessarily helpful for everyone due to troubled relationships or even absent fathers. God as Father, however, is a metaphor that Jesus uses, and one which, in this instance, communicates characteristics of God that are central to the good news, the gospel. In fact, some have referred to this story as the gospel within the gospel. The story begins with a young man asking his father for his part of his father's estate. Now, the audience of Jesus would have found this to be highly irregular and extremely disrespectful, an insult to the father. The father, however, gives the son what he's asking for, and the son proceeds to go down a path that leads to suffering and despair rather than joy and success. Even without knowing what the son would eventually do with his inheritance, one might take issue with the father for having responded to his son's request the way he did. Maybe he should have withheld that money, just said no, or put it in some sort of trust where the son was limited to how much he could withdraw at one time, or at least given him a big lecture on what he should and shouldn't do with those funds. Jesus' point, however, would seem to be that God, like the father in the story, gives God's children, us, freedom. God has given us the freedom to do right and to do wrong, to make choices. God did not create us as robots programmed to do exactly what we ought to do, what God would want us to do. God gives us all the freedom to do what we will, even if we end up breaking God's heart, as the son of the story must have done to his father when he left home under those circumstances. Fast forward to the story's conclusion. We all remember how the son ended up squandering his inheritance and found himself in a pig pen, not only feeding the pigs, but also yearning to fill his own belly with what the pigs themselves were eating. Finding himself in such a spot, we read where the son comes to his senses, decides to return home, hoping that his father would make him a hired hand, not dreaming that he would be treated again like a son. Making his way home, we read that while he was a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. While we read where the son confesses his sins to the father, this comes after the father's embrace, not before. This is incredibly important, and what I hope we all take to heart. The father in our story did not wait for his son to make amends or grovel at his feet begging for forgiveness. The father would appear to have been waiting a long time for this day of his son. Just as the son in our story encountered a father who was more gracious and loving than he could imagine, so too can we encounter a God who is exceedingly gracious and loving, more than we could ever imagine. A patient God who waits for us, who does not give up on us. A God who loves us first, not after we clean up our acts, but before. As one scholar writes, no other image comes closer to describing the character of God than the waiting father peering down the road, longing for the son's return, then springing to his feet and wanting to meet him. Like the father in our story, God is waiting and watching for us, waiting for us to turn in God's direction. It's not that we earn God's love by doing good. It's that we put ourselves in a position like the son in our story to receive the Father's love. God is waiting for us to turn so that we might be embraced and welcomed home. God wants to give us lives that are more meaningful than we can make for ourselves through our own efforts alone. God wants to give us lives that are secure in the recognition and experience of God's love for us, and that are characterized by our love for God and for others. Lives where we love, experience the peace that only God can provide, the peace that transcends all understanding, the peace that endures.
Happy Father's Day to all of you who take on that role of father and all of our children's lives. We appreciate that. Love, honor, service, sacrifice. Those are the bullet points on the job description for Father. They are the traits that have to be learned, passed on, and lived daily. My father passed away when I was 12. My mom became both the mother and father to my younger brother and I. I was also very fortunate to have two wonderful examples of fathers, husbands, and my uncles. They loved my brother and I like we were their own children. They were veterans of Vietnam and hardworking coal miners. They led by example. When a friend or neighbor needed them, they were there. And they would often bring us along, even though we were more than likely not as much help as we could have been. But I think they wanted us to see that loyalty was important. The giving of yourself was important. They worked hard, but they made time to take all of us, fishing, attending our games and events, coaching and teaching, being present in their children's lives, and in my brother and my life. We both learned a lot from them, and I rely on those lessons every day. Love, honor, service, sacrifice. But we all have an even better example of father to follow. Jesus' dad did a pretty good job, too. BK, before kids, was not really patient and forgiving. Banishment, flood, pillar of salt, plagues. But after he shared his son with us, we got to see what being a good father really was. Jesus was a teacher of lessons from his father. Love one another, love your neighbor as yourself, do unto others as you'd have them do. Easy concepts, but hard to follow through on. To all of us, by giving free, God honored all of us by giving us free will. We can choose to believe, to forgive, to ask forgiveness. Jesus lived a life of service while relying on the words of his Father to guide him. And God allowed his Son to suffer so that we may be saved. Love, honor, service, sacrifice. I want my daughters to find spouses better than me, with more integrity, wisdom, patience, generosity, and more compassion. I've tried to be a good example of a husband and father, but I don't feel I set the bar high enough. The most important job, my most important job, is to be a good father. I realized this when my oldest daughter, Emily, squeezed my finger for the first time on the day she was born. It changed me forever. It was reinforced when our younger daughter, Grace, spent the first week of her life in the NICU at CDH. Praying and trusting in God was the only tools I had. My focus from that moment on was to help my girls become the best people they can be. They can change the world. Your children can change the world. One act of kindness and compassion, one moment of generosity, one hand up can change someone's life. That person can change a life, and so on and so on. It is our duty as fathers to give them the tools and opportunities to do that. It's not with money or things. Be present, be honest, be true. You're not here to be best pals with your children. You're here to be their dad. Love, honor, service, sacrifice. Every year on my birthday, I ask God for the same thing. To have a positive impact on someone's life in the year ahead. I will likely never know if that wish has been granted, but it doesn't really matter. I just need to hold up my hand and do it right. Love, honor, service, sacrifice. It is my Father's world. It is my world as a father.
Thank you. We have some very energized children here today who have had that great experience at Vacation Bible School. And Coach Nuzzo, our new children director, is going to give us a little bit of background as to what happened this week.
Okay, so children are lining up. I just wanted to say we had a wonderful week. Boys and girls, did you have fun at VBS? Of course. They did. They really did. We had 42 children and 33 volunteers. And the children learned the name of the VBS with G-Force, and they learned about God's love in action. And we just had a great time. We explored through crafts, games, mission projects, songs, just all kinds of fun. So we're going to share with you now two of the songs that we learned this week.
Thank you.
us go to prayer.
As we go to prayer today, we have many thoughts, concerns, and joys. There's a birth. Emma Dote Cochran, daughter of Brandon and Lindsay Cochran, granddaughter of Jeff and Andy Ellis. And we celebrate the launch of our mission trip to Guatemala as we also pray for our youth and adults every day while they are gone. In our faith community, we have new concerns. Karen Strunk and Dave Cronstadt, Nancy Loda's brother-in-law. In the wider world, we weep for those suffering from the unnecessary violence and death. The daily news shouts at us, whether it is in the Middle East, Charleston, South Carolina, or on the streets of Chicago. We pray for this church as we embark on a transitional time and pray for the discernment and fortitude of our pastoral staff as they lead us on this journey. And we pray that with their help, we can open our hearts and minds to new directions and possibilities. And finally, we pray for all fathers on this special day, those with us or in our memories. And we all ask all this in your name, as you taught us how to pray, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
thanks go to Janet Carroll, our organist today, and Doug Johnson on the keyboard, and we're grateful for all of them. Let us receive the benediction. So remember this, you go to no place by accident. Wherever you go, God has sent you. Wherever you are, God has placed you there. Christ who lives within you has something to accomplish through you. So let us believe this and go in his grace, love,